After the choir sings this song, the next voice you will hear will be the minister of the hour, our friend and brother, the Reverend Cedric Hrabowski from Galilee Baptist Church in Fairfield, Alabama. Cedric is, by every definition, a homeboy. He is a graduate of the Birmingham Public School System, West End. Can any good thing come out of West End? Amen. Come see. He is serving at Galilee and has been there for 13 years. He is also a graduate of the Estonian Baptist Bible College, where he serves now as one of their trustees. He's also a board member of the Mount Pilgrim Baptist District Association. Been mayor for 24 years, and he's the father of three. He's a good man. I asked him, what you want me to say about you? And he didn't say that stuff. He just said, tell him I'm saved.
Yeah, all right.
Amen. I'm sure he's going to show you that he believes in Jesus Christ. After the choir sings, the next voice you'll hear will be Reverend Hrabowski. Raise your right hand and say, Reverend Hrabowski, preach the word.
Preach the word.
Preach the word.
Church say amen.
Amen.
Let the church say amen again.
Amen.
One more time, church, like you mean it.
Amen.
One for the Father, one for the Son, and one for the Holy Spirit. Yes. Certainly God is a good God.
Yes.
And he is worthy to be praised. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
All right, that sounds good. Before we go another further, would you bow with me in a word of prayer. Father God, we come now in the name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord God, for what we have seen and for what we have heard. We ask now, Lord God, that you would continue to be in our midst, that you would bless this, our time together, that you would bless the preaching of your word, that you would touch the hearts and the minds of your people, and that, oh God, you would use the preacher to that end, that your people will be blessed and that you will be glorified. It is in the name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus the Christ, that we do pray. And the people of God said, amen again. Y'all feel all right this morning? All right. Y'all sound pretty good. Eh? Amen. 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 I'm glad y'all feel all right. I have been blessed through the song, through the mind. Amen. The prayer, the reading of scripture has been a tremendous blessing. I feel pretty good. I feel like I could just say Jesus. Then just go ahead and sit down. Because I've already been blessed. Amen. The last time I was here has been a few years ago. How long has it been, Joya?
16 and a half years.
It's been 16 years. The last time I was here, I presided over the wedding of Steve and Joya Posey. Amen. 16 years. Amen. That's good. You've been putting up with Steve for 16 years. Y'all say a special prayer for Joy. Amen. Amen. But it's good to be here again. I must admit that I was taken aback when Pastor Sparks and I came out and I saw Cedric Sparks directing the choir. Amen.
Amen.
And I said, well, he's musically inclined as well. Amen. Man of many talents, a man of many hats. Amen. And it was good to see that. Amen. I'd like to recognize my family with me, my wife, my lovely wife, my beautiful daughter, and my handsome son. I'm cautious in calling my son handsome because he already thinks he's Adonis. And, y'all wave your hands back there. It's my wife, my daughter, and my son. Amen. We're glad to have them with us today. We'd like to recognize the First Lady. I think I saw her behind me somewhere. Amen, Sister Sparks. Good to see you. I want to thank your pastor for having invited us to come and to share the gift that is ours to share. All right. Now, I know that your pastor is a sagacious preacher and that he is both profound and proficient. But I struggle a little bit. You can't see it, but I got a limp, and I need you to help me to get to where I'm going. And I know that he says that y'all like to take notes and stuff like that, but you have the ability to help me get to where I'm going. And that is by saying amen as I preach. Are y'all walking with me?
Yeah.
Amen. That sounds pretty good. Can you do just a little better? Amen. All right, because see now, Galilee, if Galilee were here, they could tell you, I can preach for a solid hour. But if you say amen, that'll get cut down some. Amen. Y'all got it. Amen. If you keep doing that, we won't be as long as we would have been. And I thank God that no one knows how long that is. All right. Amen. But it is a blessing to be anywhere for 101 years. Amen. And you ought to be grateful to Almighty God for using this church family for this length of time. Amen. And the fact that God continues to use you. Your pastor did give me your theme and your theme passage, but God led me to a different place, all right? And I thought I might come here and try to do like your pastor and be, you know, profound and proficient. And but I think I probably just need to be myself. Is that okay with y'all? Can I just be myself? Can I just be the boy that came out of Titusville and went through West End and now lives in Ensley and who pastors in Fairfield? All right. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Now, that may mean I get a little loud and stuff like that, but y'all just bear with me. Okay. All right. I want to look at Acts, the book of Acts. And I want to direct your attention to chapter 9. I'm going to read quite a few verses for your hearing. Please be patient with me. But I don't want a chance that you already know the story. Amen? Saul chapter 9 is about Saul's conversion. And I want to read in your hearing verses 1 through 19. Amen? And it reads thusly. Now Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked for letters from him to the synagogues at Damascus, so if he found any belonging to the way, both men and women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. And it came about that as he journeyed, he was approaching Damascus, and suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. And he fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" And he said, "Who art thou, Lord?" And he said, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But rise and enter the city, and it shall be told you what you must do." And the men who traveled with him stood speechless, hearing the voice, but seeing no one. And Saul got up from the ground, and though his eyes were open, he could see nothing. And leading him by the hand, they brought him into Damascus. And he was 3 days without sight, and neither ate nor drank. Now there was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias. And the Lord said to him in a vision, "Ananias," and he said, "Behold, here am I, Lord." And the Lord said to him, "Arise and go to the street called Straight, and inquire at the house of Judas for a man from Tarsus named Saul. For behold, he is praying. And he has seen in a vision a man named Ananias come in and lay his hands on him so that he might regain his sight." But Ananias answered, "Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much harm he did to thy saints at Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priests to bind all who call upon thy name." But the Lord said to him, "Go, for he is a chosen instrument of mine to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the sons of Israel. For I will show him how much he must suffer for my name's sake." And Ananias departed and entered the house, and after laying his hands on him, said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road by which you were coming, has sent me so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And immediately there fell from his eyes something like scales, and he regained his sight, and he arose and was baptized. And he took food and was strengthened. Amen. I want to talk about, for just a few moments, Saul's conversion. Saul's conversion. You might be asking the question, "Reverend, why do you want to talk about Saul's conversion?" Because this is the church's anniversary. Well, I want to talk about it because it is in the book of Acts, and Acts is about the beginning of the church as you and I know it today. And I think, my brothers and sisters, if we look at Saul's conversion, that we can get a microcosmic look at the macrocosmic work of the church. Are y'all going to walk with me today? I think here we can catch a glimpse of what the church ought to be doing in the community. I think that we can look at Saul's conversion experience, and we can glean a few things from this experience to help us to know what we as believers ought to find ourselves doing. I'd like to pause right here to suggest to you that this building, 45th Street, is not the church, that it is the edifice where the church comes to worship. Somebody ought to hear me. I'd like to share with you that wherever you go, you are the church. Wherever you are, you represent the church. Are y'all going to walk with me? Whatever you say, it is the church speaking at that moment. Somebody ought to hear me, that the church is not an organization, but it is an organism. It is an organism of baptized believers, those of us who have accepted Jesus as our Lord and as our Savior. But as we look at Saul's conversion, I believe that
and we can see the mission for ourselves. And I'd like to share with you that we have many great things that we do, but I'd like to suggest to you that the mission for the church is not confined within these four walls. The true mission of the church happens when you leave here, when you walk out of here, when you get in your vehicle, and when you go back to your own neighborhood. That's the church's mission. Wherever you are, the work of the church ought to find itself happening there. Somebody ought to say amen. Yeah, my brothers and sisters, so what is it? What is it that we need to glean from this? Well, first of all, let's think about the human condition. Anybody here recognize that we are living in a world that needs change? Anybody here recognize that we are living in a world that is very dangerous? Anybody here willing to accept with me that, you know, I know that your pastor is a lawyer and he knows about the law, but may I suggest to you that the law has its place, but may I suggest to you that the law cannot change a man's heart? That the law is not necessarily the thing that is going to make our community safe. Are y'all gonna walk with me? That the law, that there are laws on the books, but there are still folk going to jail because they don't pay attention to the laws that are on the, y'all ain't walking with me. They don't pay attention to the laws that are on the book. You know, you're not supposed to go through a red light, but if it's at night and there ain't no club goers in here, is it? You on your way home from the club at 2 o'clock in the morning, you know that you're not supposed to run the red light, but you look to your left, you look to your right. Nobody, you don't see the police, no cars coming. Somebody ought to hear me. And there you are, you the lawbreaker. You run through that, somebody, y'all ain't walking with me. Amen. That it is not the laws that will change our communities. Are y'all gonna walk with me? But it is our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. I'd like to suggest to you this morning, my brothers and sisters, or this afternoon, my brothers and sisters, that the church is in the business of conversion. That it is in the conversion business, that we exist to introduce people to Christ. That we exist in these communities so that we can turn lives around. That's why we come here to fellowship, but we go out to fight a spiritual battle. Y'all ain't walking with me this morning. Well, let's look at Saul. Saul is angry. Saul is angry. He is in a murderous rage. Someone says, well, Saul is not a murderer. Well, he's not really a murderer himself, but he helps. He helps because he wants to get rid of all of the believers. He wants to rid himself of all of the followers of the way. He is angry because there are persons in his community who do not believe as he believes. Somebody ain't walking with me. He is upset because there are some folk who worship in the mosque and not in the church. Y'all, somebody ought to hear me. He is upset. He's on fire because there are people who call on Allah and not Jesus Christ. Y'all ain't walking with me. He is upset because there are people who are not into legalism like him, but they are talking about grace. He's upset because there are some folk who are preaching and teaching something that he does not believe in. And rather than him praying for them, rather than him attempting to exemplify what is right, Saul wants to do a kind of genocide. He wants to get rid of folk. He wants to, y'all ain't walking with me. Paul is a religious fanatic. Y'all ain't hearing me. He knows all of the rules and the regulations, but he wouldn't know Jesus. Somebody ought to, y'all ain't. Knows all of the religious regulations. He knows that he's supposed to wear his black suit on the first Sunday. Somebody ought to hear me. He knows that Bible study is, what night is your Bible study? Is on Wednesday night. He knows that prayer service may be on Wednesday night as well. He's got all of the legal stuff in the line. He knows how the program is supposed to run. He knows all of that. He's got the legal stuff down. And Paul is what I call church folk. You know anybody like that? Do you know some church folk? They come to church, but they angry when they come. Somebody ought to hear me. They come in here and they hear the preaching, but they angry when they leave. Somebody ought to hear me. You run up on them in the grocery store somewhere, they angry in the grocery store. Somebody ought to hear me. They don't have anything to have joy about. They are not happy about anything. Saul needs to meet Jesus. He's a church member. He's a religious fanatic. And I'd like to suggest to you, to all my brothers and sisters, that there are other religious fanatics, even in our day. That there are religious fanatics who call themselves being a part of Islam, but they want to go and bomb places and cause terror. Then there are people who call themselves Christians who are religious fanatics as well, because they would go last night, take a pig head and throw it in front of a mosque. Somebody ought to hear me. Degrading what someone else calls their holy ground. Are y'all going to walk with me? The Christ that I know does not condone actions like that. Somebody ought to hear me. In the name of Jesus, you would go to Planned Parenthood and shoot up some folk. In the name of Jesus, you would go to a black church and shoot some people who are trying to study about our Lord and our Savior. All in the name of Jesus, these are religious fanatics. All of the religious fanatics are not dead. But there are other fanatics. Some of them are right here in Eastlake. There are fanatics who sell drugs, who won't do anything else. See, y'all are not walking with me. They won't go to church. They won't get a job. All they want to do is get their hustle on. There are other fanatics who are fanatical about the colors that they wear, or they are fanatical about the neighborhood that they live in. And you know they're fanatical because they got tennis shoes thrown across the line, or sneakers, or whatever you want to call it, marking off their territory. And don't have a deed to anybody's property. How can you call property yours? You don't have a deed. You don't own nothing. You're living in government facilities, and you talking about it's your hood. You need to get you a job. And somebody ought to hear me. So that you can get out of that place, and you can buy you a home, and it can be part of yours. There's all kind of fanatics in the world. But how do fanatics get that way? How do fanatics, I used to hang out in this area back in the late 70s and early 80s. I used to hang out in this East Lake area down in Avondale, you know, all back out in this eastern area. Y'all ain't walking with me. I've been in church all my life, but I ain't been good. Somebody ought to help me up in here. y'all gonna walk with me? And I know some folk who do some crazy things. I still know some of them today. I know some folk that don't want you to know their real names. I have a friend now. We used to call him Beanhead all the time, but since he got saved, we can call him by his real name now. We can call him Harold now. But he didn't want anybody to call him Harold because he didn't want the popo to know his real, somebody ought to hear me. He was a fanatic about that. He'd fight you if you called him by his real name. Somebody, y'all ain't walking with me. I know people whose grandfather was incarcerated. Their father was incarcerated, and they think that they need to go that route. Somebody ought to hear me. Third generation gangsters, third generation hood boys. Somebody ought to hear me. Y'all ain't walking with me. And they think that that's the way that they ought to go. I know some young ladies who think that taking a whipping from your man is him teaching you that he loves you. Are y'all going to walk with me? How do people become fanatic? How do they get that way? How do folk get their lives so messed up? Well, I want to share with you that the main thing is sin. Sin, that's common to all of us. Sin. But may I suggest to you that we are who we are because of where we come from? Y'all are not walking with me. Is that we are who we are because of the homes that we've lived in? We are who we are because of the information that we have received along the way? Somebody ought to hear me. If you find somebody that's a big liar, 9 times out of 10, they come out of a home of liars. Somebody, y'all ain't walking with me. Huh? You learn things at home. Whether it's good or bad, you pick up things in the house. That baby boy, my cousin was his babysitter when he was about 2 years old, sent him down and she would get him every day. She lived up the street from us. And one day he came home saying some stuff that I know he didn't get out of our house. Somebody ought to hear me. And I said, where did you get that from? He wouldn't say anything, but when I asked his mom, I said, really, what did he say when she told me what he said? And I can't repeat it here. When she told me what he said, I said, oh, that's the babysitter. That's That's the babysitter. That's my cousin. He learned that from her. And I'd like to share with you that when people have these kinds of issues, it is learned behavior. Someone taught it to them. They learned it somewhere. They were observing someone that was into that. Are y'all walking with me? Well, pastor, you need to prove that. Preacher, you need to prove that. Well, let's consider Saul. Let's consider the fact that he is from Tarsus. Let's consider the fact that his father is a devout Jew. Let's consider the fact that his mother died when he was around 9 years old. And so at the age of 9, he started having pain and struggle. And his daddy was teaching him about the law. Are y'all going to walk with me? When he needed someone to hug him. When he needed a mother to rub his scrapes and bruises. When he needed someone to pick him up. When he needed someone to teach him how to be gentle. Are y'all going to walk with me? He lived in Tarsus, which was a trade area, and all kinds of folk traveled through Tarsus. So while he was hearing his father teach him about Judaism, he was looking out into the world and seeing all of the people that his father had disdain for. And he could hear his daddy talking about these folk who were beneath them. He could hear his father telling him about the folk who were not worthy to come into their company. He could hear his father talking about, y'all ain't walking with me. You know there are some folk like that today. They don't think you're worthy to come into their company because you are a few shades darker than they are. There are some folk who don't think that you are worthy to come into their company because you don't ride like they do, or you don't have the same amount of money they do, or you don't live in a gated community like they do. There are some messed up folk in this. Somebody ought to hear me. He sees his father and he hears his father. He hears his father saying all of these things as he's watching all kind of folk travel through Tarsus. He's getting angrier and angrier. He's believing his father's rhetoric. And when he becomes a man, how dare these Christians come into Jerusalem? How dare these followers of the way come into Jerusalem? How dare these folk come in here talking about resurrection? I know that there's going to be a resurrection, but that's somewhere down the road. How can they call this man the Messiah? He's not the Messiah. How can they call him God? I'm monotheistic. You can't have a God in heaven and a God walking on the earth. How can they say this? Tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to get rid of every one of them. He's angry. Wants to get rid of everybody. Saul has a problem. There are people in our world today who have a problem. But how? How, my brothers and sisters, how do we deal with fanaticism? How do we get folk from things that they have learned all of their lives? How do we get people to change from their way of life? How do we get folk to live differently, to walk differently, to love differently, to embrace one another? How do we get people to be able to look beyond our differences and speak to folks' needs? How do we get to that place? Well, I think we can see it in the text. Saul is angry. And may I share with you that when your sin is unchecked, that it magnifies? Because Saul has gotten to the place that he's not satisfied with persecuting Christians in Jerusalem. He wants to go outside of Jerusalem now. He wants to expand his territory. Somebody ought to hear me. He wants to go to Damascus, and he gets some legal paperwork so that no one will stop him and so that the Roman government will be with him. He gets paperwork so when he gets there, no one will hinder the process. He wants to hurt some more folk. Sin is unchecked. It grows. When sin is unchecked, it gets out of control. Y'all act like y'all don't know what I'm talking about. You know, you started out having just one drink. One drink turned into two drinks. Two drinks turned into three drinks. Three drinks turned... Y'all ain't walking me. Y'all been good. There ain't no drinkers in here, y'all. Y'all holy folk up in here. Y'all, I must be at the wrong church. There ain't no... Somebody ought to hear me. But baby, I tell you, I was just going to go over there and I was just going to meet with Bebe one time. He just looked so good. I was just going to go over there one time. I love my husband, but I was just going to go over there one time. But he was so good to me. I found myself going back again and again. Somebody ought to hear me. Y'all ain't walking with me. Somebody ought to help me up in here. Saying to take you further than you wanted to go and make you stay longer than you wanted to. Sin unchecked will take you into places that you never imagined that you would go. Now, how do we fix people? How do we get there? How do we get folk to change their minds? Well, what happens in the text is, if Saul is on his way, he's on his way to persecute some more Christians. But what happens to Saul is, he is confronted by the Christ. If you want to know what will change the world, if you want to know what will change Eastlake and Birmingham and Roebuck and Inslee, if you want to know what will slow the murders down, these fanatical folk need to be confronted. They need to be confronted by Christ. They don't need to be confronted with religion. They need to be confronted by our Savior. They don't need to be confronted with pull your pants up. They don't need to be confronted with you need to get a job. They don't need to be confronted with get your life together and then come to church. Why are you telling folk to get their life together and then come to church? You in here and you ain't all together. Tell the truth about it. You come in here every Sunday, you still messed up. You come in here every Sunday, your mind still go to the wrong. He needs to be confronted by Christ. He needs to have an intimate altercation with the Creator. Are y'all gonna walk with me? It happens here in the text. But may I pause for just a moment? Because I don't believe that this is Saul's first encounter with the Christ. His first encounter, you got to go back to chapter 7. In chapter 7, a fellow by the name of Stephen is preaching to the Sanhedrin. And as he's preaching, they get angry. Saul is there. He's young. He's there. And when they get ready to stone Stephen, they give their coats to Saul, and Saul holds their coats while they stone Stephen. But I'd like to share with you that Saul was confronted in that instance by Christ, because Saul is an intelligent man. Saul has what is tantamount to today an Ivy League education. And what Saul likes, he likes to see and hear intelligent people. Maybe before now, all he's heard was shouting believers, folk who are turning over pews and shouting and running up and down the aisles. But on this particular day, he hears an intelligent believer. He hears, y'all ain't walking with me, he hears Stephen expounding on the word of God. He hears Stephen take them, y'all ain't walking with me, from Abraham to Jesus Christ. He hears him. He's done his exegetical work. He knows the scripture just as Paul does. Y'all ain't walking with me. And Saul looks at Stephen. He admires his intellect. He admires his ability to handle the word of God. And it is at that moment that in the midst of his sharing out of the word of God that he is confronted by Christ. May I share with you? My brothers and sisters, you ought to know at least one verse. Amen. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. You ought to know at least one verse. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in me should not perish but have. Y'all ain't walking with me. You ought to know at least one verse. He will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee. You ought to know at least one verse, and every now and then somebody ought to hear you talking about a verse that you love out of scripture. Someone ought to hear you expounding on the word of God, not to beat them up, but just to share some truth. Y'all ain't walking with me. Folk ought to hear you saying, when they're running out here trying to grab everything for themselves, the earth is the Lord's and fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. You ought to know at least one verse. Some folk ought to be confronted by Christ when you are sharing out of the word of God. There are some people who ought to be confronted by the living Christ when you are sharing with them what thus saith the Lord. But not only does he share his testimony, not only is he confronted with Stephen doing his exegetical work and expounding and preaching the word of God, but he is confronted in the same instance when they start to stone him. Lord have mercy. He is confronted by Stephen's life. Y'all ain't walking with me. You see, we got too many folk that can quote scripture but can't walk in it. They can talk, but they can't walk. You know somebody like that? They can talk it. They can quote scripture back and forth. They can go up and down, but they ain't walking in none of it. They can quote you a scripture and get you on the parking lot and cuss you out. Somebody ought to hear me. Y'all ain't walking with me. They can quote scripture and stick you in your back. They can quote scripture and gossip about your situation. Y'all are not walking with me. Not only is Stephen preaching it, but he's living it. Somebody ought to help me up in here. He's living it. He's walking in it. Well, preacher, how do you say it? How do you believe that? Well, when they begin to stone him, he looks to heaven. He's confronted by Christ because of how Stephen responds to their negativity. He is confronted by Christ because he's wondering, if this fella is lying, how can he keep hold to this lie as he's being stoned? Wouldn't he deny Christ as the stones are hitting him? Doesn't he know that he is about to die? Wouldn't he turn away from that foolishness? He is confronted by Christ at that moment. And may I share with you that in your difficult moments, in your trials and tribulations, when you are being confronted by the stones of life, when the devil is throwing his best stuff at you, but you just keep calling on the name of Jesus, you just keep saying that the Lord is good, you just keep praising him anyhow, you just keep thanking God for another day, when you do that in the midst of lost folk, they will be confronted by the Christ. Are y'all gonna walk with me? I got a few more points. I gotta hurry up and get there. Somebody ought to hear me up in here. But not only that, but when they start hitting him and he's about to die and he knows, he repeats what his Savior says. He looks to heaven and he says, Jesus, take my spirit into your hand. And then he says another thing about the folk who are stoning him. He looks at them and he says, don't charge this sin to them. Are y'all gonna walk with me? How many of us can do that? How many of us can have folk wrong us, talk about us, put us down, and then look to heaven and say, Lord, don't make them pay for it? We're in the business of asking God to knock folk down, not to lift them up. Somebody ought to hear me. He says, don't charge it to them. They really don't know what they are doing. Are y'all going to walk with me? We've got to be like Jesus. I hear folks say, I can forgive, but I can't forget. Are y'all going to walk with me? You may not forget. You can forgive, but if you forgive and don't pick it up again, y'all ain't walking with me. If I wrong you and you can love me in spite of my wronging you, then your light is shining. If I can do wrong to you and you do right back to me, then your light is shining. I know that the culture tells you to get back, but may I tell you that you are supposed to be a citizen of heaven. He's confronted by Christ through his witness. He's confronted by Christ through Stephen's testimony and through Stephen's life. These next points are going to be shorter, but anybody here, you just like God? Man, I tell you, I like God. Matter of fact, I love God. I love God because of what God does. I love God because every now and then, Cedric, God flaunts himself. Somebody ought to hit me. Every now and then, God just flaunts. Every now and then, God flaunts his godness. Yeah, like y'all don't know what I'm talking about. Every now and then, God just does something that only he can do. Somebody ought to hear me. Every now and then, God just shakes himself. And he says, look, who can do what I can? Y'all ain't walking with me. Every now and then. And it is not arrogance, because whatever God says about himself is true. I may say something about myself that may not be true, but if God says that he's great, it's true. If God says he's everlasting, it's true. Somebody ought to hear me. If God says he's all-knowing, it's true. If God says he's the best thing that you could ever have, it's true. If I tell my wife, honey, I'm the best thing you could ever have, she might say, yeah, that's true. Y'all ain't walking with me. Somebody ought to hear me up in here. But God, every now and then, flaunts his godness. And he right here, he's flaunting his godness. Because God shows up at Ananias' house. He says to Ananias, I want you to go and I want you to talk to this fellow named Saul. Because he knows that you're coming. He knows that you're going to lay hands on him, that you're going to help him. And you're going to help him to see. You're going to help him to get his appetite back. Ananias said, wait a minute, God. I've heard about this fella. This fella has been persecuting the church in Jerusalem. Not only that, God, but I heard that he's got papers to come here to Damascus to persecute the rest of us who are followers of the way. You mean to tell me, God, that that's the fella that you want me to go to? Here is God flexing himself. God says to Ananias, he's the one. He is my chosen. What? He's a chosen vessel. I've chosen Saul for myself. What? I've chosen him to do my work. May I share with you that I'm tired of being in church and not seeing God flaunt himself. I'm tired of being in church and not seeing God come in and say, I'm God. I'm tired of being in church and going through the routine. Can I tell you that I want to be in church and I want to see God flaunt himself. I want to see God do the miraculous. I'm tired of the minute and minuscule. I want to see God do that which is grandiose. Somebody saying, well, what is that? It's taking somebody like Saul, changing his heart and his mind, making him out of a preacher, making him go, y'all ain't hear me, using him to write 2/3 of the New Testament, taking somebody like Saul, somebody, y'all didn't catch that, taking somebody like a Negro out of West End named Cedric Sean Hrabowski, taking him out of the streets, changing his heart and his mind, saying, I want you to preach my word. I'm tired of the mundane. I want to see God bring the drug dealers in. Change their hearts and their minds. I want to see God changing the hearts and the minds of the prostitutes and the pimps. I want to see God flaunting himself. I want to see God doing that which is miraculous. I want to see God save Bebe and them that y'all left at the house this morning. I want to see God get the gangsters out of your neighborhood and make them into God's men. I want to see God do the miraculous. I want to see God flaunt himself. I want to see God fill up the choir with Negroes that came out of the penitentiary. I want to see God flaunt himself. I'm tired of just coming to church. I want to see God move in a mighty way. Moves in a mighty way. He says Saul is a chosen vessel. Somebody ought to hit me. See, what I need for you to do today is I need for you to stop putting limitations on God. I need for you to stop looking at the souls of the world and saying there's no hope for them. I need for you to stop looking at, how many of y'all got somebody in your family that need to be saved?
Should be more hands than that in here. Should be more hands than that in here. You know you left some liars at the house. You know you left some whoremongers at the house. You know you left Bebe drinking a beer when you was on your way here. You know you got somebody at the house that needs for God to confront them. You need for God to change their life. My oldest son is not here with me today. I need for God to touch him. I need for God to fix him. I need for God to turn his life around. I need for God to give him a new walk, a new talk, a new step. I need for God to do for him what I can't do. I've done everything that I can do. But now I need for God to show up and flex himself. Tired of folks putting limitations on God. Ain't no hope for them boys around the corner. Ain't no hope for them boys down the street. Somebody ought to hear me. Ain't no hope for them Negroes throwing the tennis shoes on the line. Well, I want to tell you, I used to run with them. And now I'm here this morning preaching in your church. Y'all ain't walking with me. I want to tell you, I used to sell drugs in this community, but now I'm here preaching in your church. And I'm pastoring in Fairfield. I'm proof that God does the miraculous. I'm proof that God can flex. You got to do your part. You got to do your part. And when you do your part, God will certainly do his part. Are y'all going to walk with me? Because after this witness from Stephen, this is where God confronts him. May I share with you? May I give you just a little more of my testimony? This is 45th Street. I think somewhere between 39th Street and 41st Street, down near Avondale Projects. One Friday night, after my daddy had been confronting me with the scriptures, after my pastor had been doing his exegesis in the pulpit, they were planting the seed. They were doing their part. After my mama and my grandmama had prayed for me. Somebody ought to hear me. After the deacons at the church had prayed for me. Somebody ought to hear me. There I was after they had confronted me with Christ. One night somewhere down between 39th Street and 41st Street, I was confronted by God. There was no light shining around me like in Paul's conversion experience. But I was on my way to the club. I was headed to another level of debauchery. I had proved myself to the boys in the hood. And they were going to take me to another level of debauchery. But before I could get there, God said to me, "It's hard, Hrabowski, to kick against the prick. It's hard to turn away from me. Tonight, you got to choose life or death." He said it to me just like that. May I tell you that I told my cousin, "Take me home." He said, "But man, we were headed to the club to do this thing." I said, "No, take me home." He knew something had happened, just like the fellas in the text, but he didn't know what happened. What we were going to do, I didn't want to do anymore. Where we were going, I didn't want to go anymore. Somebody ought to hear me. God was in the car flexing himself. Somebody ought to hear me. But only I knew what God was doing. May I suggest to you, you keep telling Bebe about Jesus. You keep praying for him. You keep talking to him. You keep sharing the scripture. Because one day, Bebe going to be on his way doing what he do. And God is going to flex himself. God is going to show up. God is going to change his life. God is going to turn him around. Don't you give up on God because it looks like Bebe ain't going to never change. You can give up on Bebe, but don't give up on my God. He's a chosen vessel. May I share with you, there are chosen vessels all around here, but they have not been confronted by Christ. When you leave church, don't tell them about your pastor. Tell them about Jesus. When you leave church, don't tell them about Hrabowski, because my name can't save anybody. Tell them about a man named Jesus. When you leave church, don't talk about the deacons. Tell them about Jesus. When you leave church, don't talk about the choir. Talk about Jesus. When you leave church, don't talk about the trustees. tell them about Jesus. When somebody asks you how you got saved, don't tell them you got baptized, you found the Lord. Tell them one day a man named Jesus came into my life. He made the difference in my life. He turned my life around. He put my feet on solid ground. His name is Jesus. 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 J-E-S-U.
When it's all said and done, the only thing that matters is Jesus. It's not the messenger, but it's the focal point of the message. God bless you, Sid. God bless you, Reverend Hrabowski. Somebody here needs to know Jesus. Somebody here has been riding under the comfort and security of church. You've been coming in here, just coming to church, but you don't know the Lord. You've never accepted him for yourself. See, it's easy to come in and blend in. It's easy to sing and to clap. It's easy to leave and still be in the same condition. But at some point, you have to confront your own reality, and that is ask yourself, do I know Jesus? Have I accepted him for myself? Because when it's all said and done, you're not fooling anybody but yourself. I'm extending to you the invitation to accept Jesus Christ as your Savior. I'm extending to you the invitation to admit to yourself that until this day you didn't know whether or not you were going to heaven, whether or not you would live eternally. But right now you've come to realize that Jesus is available to you. I'm extending to you right now the opportunity to accept that invitation. It's the greatest gift you could give yourself, is to accept the Lord's gift of his only begotten Son. It's been made just as plain. If somebody like Saul, could be converted, then there's hope for anybody. If somebody like Saul, who hated everything about Jesus.
Well, there it is. I hope you were blessed by the God's word. It's my prayer that you will grow from this message. But in case you need a refresher, you can always stop by our physical location and worship with us at 7600 Division Avenue over in the Eastlake community. I believe one visit and you'll find out that we truly are the friendliest church from the parking lot to the pulpit. Looking forward to meeting you. God bless you. Take care.